Greetings and welcome. I'm Richard Burrow. This is Strategic Business Development, Mastermind Alliance. And this is Chalk Talk, and it'll run automatically. Enjoy it. The Chalk Talk we're going to go through here is called Start, Write, and Win. It's a brand new year, folks. 2013. We got through that 21st of December date. Okay, and the world didn't come to an end yet, so we're going to go right ahead. But look, 12 months. Look at all that opportunity. 52 weeks, 365 days minus the few we've already gone through. Lots and lots of opportunity for your business. So we're going to discuss some work smart behaviors that will help you win. And in order for you to do what we want you to do to maximize your success, be sure to have these win-generating behaviors in place, and then use them habitually forever, as long as you are in business. Play great or get beat. That's the ticket. So before we go into there, the new stuff, we want to look at where you are today and check the score. We want to review your recent history, look at your net income, your time spent worrying, your contentment, all that kind of thing. You want to look at that before you go ahead. Remember, your grand strategy is the way in which you make sure everything about your business creates buyers and makes profits for you forever and ever and ever. That's never going to change. Remember that your sales-generating behavior, well, that's the engine that drives all of your success. And it's got to be powerful and well-maintained and powerful and well-maintained and powerful and well-maintained. Forever. And sales-generating behavior, oh, that's the things that you say and the things that you do that get people to give you money. That's all it is. Money. Stuff's great. Want a lot of it. If you set out to make a cake, you're going to follow a recipe and mix some ingredients together. It have to be the right ingredients. You're going to warm up the oven, get it to the right temperature, then put the cake in there and bake it. Then you're going to take it out. When it's done, after it cools off, you're going to put some frosting on it. Then you'll be able to eat it and enjoy it. That's the recipe for making a cake. So what's the recipe for making money in your business? Well, we have an analogy. Fishing is nearly a perfect analogy for making money in a business. I don't know if that's the very best way to fish right there, but it seems to be working for that fellow. So let's look at how to catch a fish, the steps. First, you figure out where the fish you want to catch are most likely to be found. Are they in a river, a stream, the ocean, a pond, a lake? And what part of those things, those places, will you most likely find the fish that you want to catch? Got to start knowing where to go. Then you get all the stuff you need and you go there. If it happens to be a lake in another county, you got to get in your car and drive there, well, so be it. Third step, you attract with bait in the water. You put some sort of bait in the water to attract the fish you want to catch. That's the third step. Fourth, you hook one. Hooray, you got one. Fifth, you get that fish into your net. Get control of that fish. Catch it. And then you take it home and enjoy it. That's how you catch a fish. Making money is a lot like that. And if you're not making enough money, I have news for you. It can only be one thing that's holding you back. Insufficient, profitable sales. Now maybe you have a lot of sales, but the profits aren't there. you need to have sufficient high profit sales. There we're going to be running you through some questions that reveal why profitable sales are at the present perhaps insufficient, and we'll get you started with improvements so you can make more money. 13 little questions. And here we go. 13 questions. They're yes or no questions. First one. Do you sell things people need or want? Basic stuff. If you're trying to sell things people don't want or need, that's never going to work. So that's the first question. Do you sell things people need or want? And the answer probably is yes. Number two, can people actually afford to buy those things? If the price is too high, of course they can't. If they're priced in a way they can, they will, because they want them or they need them. So the answer to that is probably yes. Three, when people buy, do you make a profit? Is there money left over? Now, hopefully the answer here is yes. We want it to be a bigger yes, a resounding yes. But if it's a no, well, we got to back up and figure out what's wrong with that. So let's say it's a yes. Four, can you describe your ideal customer? Now, this is a little bit like the fishing. What is the kind of fish you want to catch? What is your ideal customer? Male, female, young, old, educated, not so much. Where do they live? What are their habits? The more you know about them, the better. Five, do you know what your top selling offering is? And do you know what the behavior that sells that is? Need to know top selling behavior and the offering and the behavior that sells it. Because some things are easier to sell than others. And maybe use some kind of behavior to sell some things. And you had a different kind of behavior to sell something else. Got to be clear on this. You probably could be more clear than you are now on this item right here. Six, is your customer or client attraction process working well enough to meet your objectives? Well, if it is, you're making lots of money. If it's not, you're not. And the little fish is behind there teasing you because you put your line in the wrong place or the wrong kind of bait or there's something not working right. This you could probably improve upon. So the question might be maybe or sometimes, but probably not a resounding yes. Seven, do you know how to make your marketing work better? Maybe you do and maybe you don't. We want to help you make it work better. We spend an awful lot of time in this program helping people improve their marketing strategy and their sales behavior. Number eight, are you leading and inspiring people? Getting them to do what you want. By that people, I mean clients and customers. I also mean coworkers, employees, partners, anyone who is remotely connected to your business in any way. Are you leading and inspiring them? Got to do that. Can you do a better job on that? Better job of that? Sure you can. Nine, do you have the mindset, determination, and persistence required to do whatever it takes to never give up, to push that rock up the hill every single day, even though it often rolls back down time to the hill at night when you stop pushing, and the next day you have to start over again? But a lot of people don't have this, and they're not probably going to be in business for themselves very long. They might be better off as employees to somebody else, but none of you folks are in this category. You all can say yes. You have the mindset, determination, and persistence. Sure, you could get better at it, but you already have that, or you wouldn't be where you are at all. Number 10, do you have the advisory input you need to overcome obstacles and to exploit opportunity? You need advice. You don't know everything. If you're a member of the Mastermind Labs, yes, you have this. You have it in spades. Number 11, are you well organized, unconstrained, and have you mastered time management? Well, we can always be better organized. We can also always be less unconstrained and do a always get better at mastering time because it's an issue there for us all the time. So the answer is probably sometimes, but could be better. Number 12, some people make more money than you do. This is a fact. Do you know what they do that you do not do? Do you know what they do that you do not do? The answer is probably not, or maybe, but it's probably not a resounding yes. 13, do you have a written roadmap setting forth your goals, plans, and so on? Doesn't have to be extensive. It can be something on the back of a small piece of paper. It's better if it's a couple of pages and has a few numbers in it. But you really do need to have something written down as a guide to where you're going. You have that? Probably could be better if you have one, and maybe a lot of people don't have one at all. So add it all up. How many resounding yes answers can you give to the 13 questions? How many answers are a solid no? How many answers are a maybe? This kind of tells you, when you look at the list of those questions, which ones you need to focus your attention on and make better so that money can go forward and keep coming into your business. So you have to ask yourself, what's in my way? And maybe make a list of those things. Maybe the list of things that are in your way become kind of projects for you to work on the next few weeks and months to overcome them and get rid of those roadblocks and barriers altogether. Now there's a couple more things. I'm going to review for you or talk to you about for a moment a structural analysis of the rocks and a behavioral analysis of your routines. A structural analysis. What do we see when you look underneath your rocks? What's going on down there? You have your offerings, your people, your attitudes, your marketing, delivery, profits, and systems. All these rocks are fundamental to the structure and function and operation of your business. And if there's an issue somewhere with, say, delivery or with attitudes, when you look carefully at those rocks, that tells you, okay, here's something else I got to work on. Because when I have it worked on right, when I work on it and make it better, I'll be able to make more net income. Routines as well. We're going to do a behavioral analysis. What do we find when we look at the routines? Things you check on, the things you do, especially the things you do. Where are there ways in which you can improve in those areas? This starting off the new year right, it's a good time to do these kind of things. Sometimes just doing routine things can be tricky. Even for professionals who do tricky things for a living. And even these guys can sometimes have a problem just walking. Then there's the old brick wall. You go along just fine, and all of a sudden, whoa, where did this come from? What do we do now? That can happen. And this can happen. Feel like you're going around in circles. That's never good. Does happen from time to time, sometimes. And this, well, now you're going someplace. This is so much better. Yeah, this is good. All right, you do those analyses, and those are then followed by taking action.
In a world that seems busier by the day, productivity is on the minds of many. But instead of downloading the latest time management app or forcing yourself to stay at work for hours on end, how can we use science to crack open the potential of our minds? Is there a secret to being productive? The first thing to come to terms with is that your willpower is simply not enough. In fact, some studies suggest that willpower is an exhaustible source that can be entirely used up. This is a concept known as ego depletion. So instead of convincing yourself to simply try harder, a more methodical approach is suggested. The first step? Get started. It may seem obvious, but studies have shown starting a project to be the biggest barrier to productivity. Before starting, our brain visualizes the hardest parts to come and instead tries to simulate real work by focusing on small, mindless tasks. Luckily, there's a construct of the mind known as the Zeigarnik effect, which compels humans to finish a task that they've already started. The Zeigarnik effect shows that when we don't finish a task, we experience discomfort and intrusive thoughts about it. So get started, now. What about time management? Shockingly, when we look at some of the most elite musicians in the world, we find that they aren't necessarily practicing more, but instead more deliberately. This is because they spend more time focused on the hardest task and focus their energy in packets. Instead of diluting their effort over the entire day, they have periods of intense work followed by breaks. Not relying on willpower, they rely on habit and disciplined scheduling. Studies have found that the most elite violinists in the world generally follow a 90-minute work regime with a 15 to 20-minute break afterwards. Instead of trying to maintain energy throughout the entire day, breaking it down into sessions with planned relaxation is most effective. But how can you develop the discipline to follow this routine? One key component is giving yourself a deadline. Write it down, mark it in your calendar, and you'll be much more likely to complete your task. On top of this, create something called an accountability chart to document your progress. In one column, write the time span, and in the other, the activities you accomplished during this time. Similar to those on a diet who document their food intake, writing down your progress allows you to realistically evaluate your work as opposed to inaccurately assuming what you've done. Furthermore, tracking your progress helps to avoid small, mindless work. And finally, stop multitasking. While it may feel like you're accomplishing more, studies show that multitaskers are much less productive. Instead, try and make a list at night of what you want to accomplish tomorrow. This way, you hit the ground running with your action plan and avoid trying to complete multiple activities at once. While you're at it, split up your large tasks into smaller, bite-sized ones. Your brain will find these less daunting and it will make the starting process easier. With a clear goal and action plan in mind, your productivity levels can soar to new heights. Want more tips and information on productivity? Check out Gregory Ciotti's blog, Sparring Mind, who we worked with to make this video. We'll link to the productivity article in the description where you can find even more information. And be sure to sign up for his newsletter, which covers other amazing brainy content. Got a burning question you want answered? Ask it in the comments or on Facebook and Twitter. And subscribe for more weekly science videos.
Now that you're back from the YouTube video, let's just summarize those major points. There were 9 of them. First one, easy. Willpower, never enough. Takes more than willpower to be exceedingly productive. Start. Yeah. In order to get anything done, you first have to start. Unfortunately, the Zeigarnik effect is there, because once you get started on something, you sort of feel compelled to finish. So starting helps you finish. No kidding. Deliberate practice, we've talked about that a great deal. Deliberate practice works. It's the best way to learn something is to practice it deliberately. It helps when you set a deadline, so set a deadline for yourself. I'm going to have this done by this afternoon at 2 o'clock, and this done by tomorrow afternoon. By the end of the month, these 3 things will be finished. And accountability, number one, or always number 1 or 2 things on the list of things that slows people down, prevents them from being productive, is they don't have any accountability. Now you can make an accountability chart for yourself, like in the video, or you can get a buddy, and you call the buddy and say, buddy, today I'm going to do these 3 things. I'll call you back at 3 o'clock and tell you that I'm done. And likewise, the buddy does similar things with you. Stop multitasking. Yeah, that's just never going to work. People try and try, and it just makes them more fall farther and farther behind. Do one thing, let go of it, do something else, let go of it, do something else, let go of it. To-do list the day before. That's the review preview strategy. At the end of the day, you review what you've done. You think what you need to do tomorrow, you make the list before you leave from work and go home. Then when you come in the morning, your list is right there, and you go back and start. And it's a good idea to break complicated tasks down into small little size bites. Just common sense makes it easier. Couple things about deliberate practice. Well, just one thing I wanted to review what it means for you. That's an activity that is explicitly intended to improve performance. That's all it's for. You're not going to get paid for doing that. You're just going to get better at doing something that you get paid for later. So it's activity that reaches for objectives just beyond your current level of competence. stretches you a little bit. And it provides feedback on the results, how you're doing, and always involves high levels of repetition and then more repetition and more repetition. Break the complex down into simple, practice it, practice it, practice the simple pieces, do the hard ones first, master them, then go to the easier ones. Brilliant. Brilliant idea. Now we're ready to do some work. We have looked at some issues, we have looked at some progress, we've looked at some results, we've looked at what it takes to be successful and so forth, and we want to do a little work, actual work. We're going to work on the Make More Money game plan. Big fat truth. If you're not growing, you're dying. I think that was a line in a Bob Dylan song back in the 60s or 70s. But it's true. If your business is stagnant, means other businesses around you are growing past you and they'll run by you and you'll wonder what happened when they leave you in the dust. So you continually have to be finding new ways to grow, become more productive, and more profitable. So I'd like you to set three new goals. See that at the bottom where it says BHAGs? BHAGs stands for Big, Hairy, Audacious Goals. It's a term coined by a fellow named Jim Collins, who wrote a book, several books, but the best one I think was called Good to Great, and Collins was a professor in the business school at Stanford University for a while, and then became a consultant and started writing books, and I'm not sure what he's doing today. I think he's still doing some consulting. But BHAGs are big, hairy, audacious goals. And for instance, finding a cure for cancer is a big, hairy, audacious goal. Nobody's going to make that happen in a year or so, but it's something you really need to work towards, perhaps for your whole life. I don't want you to set goals that are quite that big, but I do want them to be challenging goals. So take out a piece of paper and just go ahead and write down three big goals that you want to accomplish in this year. Big fat truth. You must be a profit-generating machine. You and those who work with you. So we want to improve your routines. Money-making routine in particular. Your essential success routine or behavior is your top money-making activity. Because you got to get as much as possible. Who knows what will happen next year, the year after, the year after. You need to get as much as possible as quickly as possible. Why not? Then you get to retire earlier. And life gets easier, not harder. You got to have one of these. You put in some money at the top, and a lot more money comes out at the bottom when you turn the crank. That's the done business machine crank. You want that. You want to have lots of this left over. Oh, yeah. In your hand, that you can use or spend or save or give to people, whatever you want to do with it, it's your choice. Your freedom to do that. So let me ask you a question. Pretty important question. How do you make this happen? What are things that you say and things that you do that get people to open their wallets, give you cash, write you a check, give you a credit card numbers, make an order, buy from you? How do you make that happen? What is the behavior, the sales-generating behavior that's attached to your top money-making activity? What is that? You need to know that. See if you can take a moment and write that down. Just a few pages, just a few words, a sentence or two. Look at this little pyramid I discovered. Actual money-making activity, that's on the top in the green. Underneath that are activities that directly engage that money-making activity. There's a setup, in other words. You have to do things that will allow you to engage in the top money-making activity. And below that, maybe some supportive administrative activities and so forth, all sorts of other things, including the scale of your business, that allow you to get eventually to that actual money-making on the very top. All those things have to be there. You have to understand them all. They all have to be working together pretty much flawlessly most of the time. Here's the deal. You figure out what you do that makes the most money. And then you do a whole lot of that. And you get the people to work with you to do a whole lot of that too. This is not rocket science stuff. This is elementary, first grade stuff. It's just maybe you never thought of it before. So let's go through it. Your top money-making activity. Please describe it. Write it down. What is it exactly? Take out a piece of paper and go through this. What is my top money-making activity? What is it exactly that I do to make that happen? How do you set it up? What activities precede your top money-making activity? You have to do things to get ready to sell, to get people in front of you, to get in front of people, to get people on the phone, to start a conversation. How do you set those things up? Do you advertise what you're marketing like and so on? Do people come to you? Do you have to go to them? What activities set up your top money-making activity? And how well does it work? That is, how well does it result in new money flowing into your business if you do your top money-making activity 10 times on a Tuesday? Does it work every time? Does it work half the time? Does it bring money into your business most of the time? If not, you know you need to tune it up and make it better. That probably won't work 100% of the time, forever and ever and ever, but it ought to work half this time, or 60% of the time, or 70% of the time, don't you think? This is real important. How much time do you actually spend on your top money-making activity each day or week? Are you spending 10 hours, 30 hours, 8 hours? What? Is it consistent each day of the week, each week of the month, each month of the year? How much time are you actually spending generating money directly yourself? And how much time of those folks who work with you directly, personally spending, generating money from the top money-making activity? You need to know that. And this one. What will it take for you to spend more time with your top money-making activity? Because that's how you make more money. You figure out how to spend more time on your top money-making activity, or how to get the people to work with you to spend more time on the top money-making activity. You need to make doing more possible. Possible. You improve your ability to make more money by increasing your power. If you're able to make more time available to make more money, you're increasing your power. Simple stuff. Give yourself the power to make more money. Do that. Do that for yourself. Do that for everyone who works with you. Dr. Terry Orlick, who's a sports psychologist and professor up in Canada, wrote a book called The Pursuit of Excellence. I recently discovered this fellow, kind of like him. Here's one of his sayings. The heart of human excellence often begins to beat when you discover a pursuit that absorbs you, frees you, challenges you, or gives you a sense of meaning, joy, or passion. I like that a lot. In Orlick's book, he talks about the 7 keys to earning more money. There they are in the picture. In the middle, we have belief and commitment. You have to believe it's possible. You have to make a commitment to do everything you possibly do to make it come true. And around the edges, we have positive imagery, mental readiness, full focus, distraction control, constructive evaluation. And there's interaction, as indicated by the arrows, amongst all those variables, those 7 variables. And look at this guy. In order to get it done, You have to have your complete, full focus on it, whatever it is. Whatever that piece of behavior that you're going to engage in is, you have to have it full focused so you can get it done. So the instruction I will give you about your behavior is simple. Implement your top money-making activity early, often, and of course, successfully. That means you got to block out all those pesky distractions, usually in the form of other people. That means sometimes you have to break through a few rules and park where you shouldn't. And it also tells you who you should focus on. There's people who matter, and there's people who you can influence, and then there's overlap in the black shaded area. That's where you want to focus on. And you got to plan, and you got to begin, and of course you got to finish what you start. So why bother to plan ahead? Well, obviously, if you don't plan ahead, you can run into all sorts of disasters, and you'll regret later on. So are you ready to go out and make just a boatload of profit, net profit? Hope you are. If you are, don't let anybody hold you back. Start. Get yourself a nice fistful of money immediately. You know, it really feels good to do that. As long as I've been in business, I still get fun. It's still fun for me to take checks to the bank. I like doing it. Probably always will. And if there are any questions about any of this kind of material, you can ask them now, or you can email us, or let us know, contact us, and we'll talk to you about them later. Thanks for your attention.